you. Well, if you're happy you're saved, can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. It's good to see everybody tonight. Thank you so much for coming. I enjoyed that little question area. That was kind of neat. Thank you, Brother Foreman. I love the Foremans. They're wonderful people, wonderful family. And we're so glad we got saved and trusted the Lord. And we played a lot of ball together, did all kinds of stuff. And I love the man. I just really love he and his wife and family. And there have been such blessings to me. I wrote a little thing down. Go to Psalm. This is not my message, but go to Psalm 121. Would you please? 121. I want to show you something. This is verse 1, 2, and 7 that I want to give to you. I just found this the other day. I thought this was so good. I lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. That's verse 1. Verse 2 says, my help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. Verse 7, the Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. Now, think about this little statement I'm going to make. It is impossible for that man to despair. You can just say it's impossible for any man to despair who remembers that his helper is omnipotent.
Amen.
Amen. Woo, how can you despair when your helper is omnipotent? My God is omnipotent.
Amen.
What does that mean, omnipotent? All powerful.
Yes. Amen.
Omniscient, what does that mean?
All knowing.
Omnipresent, what does that mean? He's everywhere. How can you despair? How can you say, I've got all kind of problems? What? Your helper is just an omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I thought that was wonderful, and I hope you enjoyed that too. All right, we're going to look at 1 Thessalonians chapter number 4. Would you please? 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Now, I would like to have you take some notes. I'm going to ask you questions as we go, and I'd like to have you answer those, and you'll answer those because you'll have it on your sheet that you're going to take a note about. This is such an important topic. I only have three major points tonight, just three. And then little sub-points in between there as well. But I want to talk to you about on that great getting up morning. On that great getting up morning. Do you ever heard that song?
Yeah.
On that great getting up morning, fare thee well, on that great getting up morning, fare thee well, fare thee well. That's neat, isn't it?
Amen.
Hey, there's a getting up morning coming.
That's right.
Yep. Amen, there certainly is. But let me tell you a story. Way down south somewhere in a little old town, little old country store, there in the south, a few raggedy young men had draped themselves over the front porch rail and were sipping on some colas. And as they sipped on the colas, they would razz people who were passing by. When up came an older lady by the name of Ms. Betsy. Ms. Betsy, a fine lady, stout, Christian woman. She'd been nourished through the years by the good book and fried chicken in a sensible living. She stopped as those boys were smirking and just kind of looked at them through her bifocals. Like that. And they were laughing and they were talking to her, and as she sized them up, she decided to go ahead and go in the store, and she did. And as she was going up the steps and about ready to enter the store, one of those young men said, hey, preacher says Jesus coming soon, Miss Bessie. You believe Jesus coming soon, Miss Bessie? Another one said. She kind of looked at him like that, flashing a glance at those boys. She straightened her shoulders and she said, I sure do, he's coming soon. And he is, sure as you're born, he's coming soon. They pressed her again. Well, ain't you better hurry up and get ready and get home so you can be ready? Jesus might be on his way right now, Miss Bessie. You better get ready. Having just stepped inside the store, she turned around and stared at those boys who were mocking her. "Y'all listen here," Miss Bessie said. "I don't have to get ready. I keeps ready." What a good answer. I don't have to get ready. I keeps ready. That's a great answer. But it begs a penetrating question. Do you also keep ready? Does everybody, listen to me, does everybody in this room, are you ready for the Lord Jesus Christ to come? Could he come today? Are you ready? Or would you have to say, whoa, I got to repent about certain things. I got to fix this before you come. Miss Bessie said, I keeps ready. Perhaps like those cynical boys in the story, you consider Christ's coming hard to accept. Some folks actually think it's like a fairy tale. So hard to understand. Or maybe you believe he's coming, but you're not quite committed like the old woman. Thoughts of meeting him face to face rarely find their way into your thought processes or your daily experiences. But you know, in the New Testament, now I want you to turn to Revelation chapter 22 just real quick, verse number 20. I want you to talk to me now in just a minute. Do you realize that over 300 times the Bible talked about the Lord's return? More than any other subject, he talked about the Lord's return. Seriously now. It's even in the final thought of Scripture. And what does he say in Revelation chapter 22 and verse number 20? Does he not say, I am coming quickly? Amen. I come quickly. Are you ready? Tonight I'm serious. I love you folks, and I love to come to this church to preach. I love Brother Foreman, Mrs. Foreman, and all of you folks. But I would hate to think that somebody in this place is not ready. Amen. I would hate to think that the time we've spent and we've laughed and we've talked and we've sang together, and yet nobody ever asks you, are you really ready? And if the Lord would come, you wouldn't go. Because of some sin, or maybe you didn't repent, you just play the game. I want you to think about that. Because he could come at any time. Our Lord could come tonight, right now. And he doesn't want to forget you. If we're not careful, though, we can take this a little too far. And I want you to understand what I'm going to talk about. We get bogged down in the miry side path of our faith. The title of my message is simply this, and I wrote it down so you wouldn't forget it and I wouldn't. On that great getting up morning. Now would you kindly stand with me and let's turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Keep your pencils handy, please. Take some notes, write down the verse of Scripture. Be ready to go to the Scripture as I read them. I may even have some of you read a Scripture, so get ready. This is fun. I love preaching. I love teaching. Amen. And I love teaching about the coming of the Lord Jesus. Amen. He's coming soon. He said he was. Now we're looking at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, one of my favorite settings of Scripture, verse 13 through verse 18. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren. He's talking to the church. I don't want you to be ignorant, he's saying, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Help me to get alive and alert. Help us to enjoy the Word of God as it's preached and taught. Give us wisdom now, we pray. But if there's anybody here, dear Lord, that's not saved, that doesn't know you, we've just been playing the game, help us to stop it tonight and get at the altar and get things right with our God. We love you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Roman numeral number 1, only going to 3, extremes we need to guard against. Now, when we talk about the coming of the Lord, there's always some extremes. Always. There's always some extreme people. And there's always some kind of a weirdo teaching out there that if we're not careful, we get hung up on. So here's what I want you to get. One extreme is fanatic intensity. Write that word, those two words down. It's characterized by an overreaction to the return of Christ. Obsessed with end-time teachings. Some people actually interpret every world event in the light of prophecy. It's always a big thing. A few even interpret and tell you, well, I know, God told me the date. As soon as somebody says, God told me the date that he's coming, I'll say, forget listening to that guy. Because no man, the Bible says, no man knows the day nor the hour when the Lord Jesus Christ is coming. So if you're listening to anybody on the radio, in the internet, and they start talking about, well, I'm going to set this date because God talked to me, God never talked to him. Amen. No, sir. You don't know when he's coming. I don't know when he's coming. Do you realize that even Jesus Christ himself does not know the day or the hour that the Father says, okay, son, go get my people. He doesn't even know. So fanatic intensity. Sometimes people will quit their job. We've had that happen. If you understand church history, we've had people quit their jobs, sell their houses, go to mountains, and said that Jesus told them to go to that mountain because that was the mountain he was going to come back to. Down in Tennessee was one. And so people would quit their jobs, follow that preacher. Fanatic intensity. Be careful. Stay with the Word of God. Don't get with some kind of fanatic intensity. All right, that's important for us to understand. The other extreme is theological ignorance. For some Christians, talk of God's prophetic timetable usually draws glassy stares and wild yawns. Unfortunately, this interest has a domino effect in our Christian life. Since they have little vision for the next world, they often lack the passion to win the lost. So because we have no vision for the next world, and I'm telling you, Jesus Christ is coming soon, and the next world is going to be established, but what we need to be concerned with is everybody in our church really saved? Are all these boys and girls saved? Are moms and dads saved? Do we really know the Lord? And if we do, it makes heaven even more exciting because we're going to take somebody with us. Amen? So don't have the ignorance that's going around in our society today. A spinoff of these extremes is theological misinformation next. Some people not only don't understand the truth, they believe what is untrue. That makes matters worse. Now, Mark Twain, and I wrote this down, you got to listen to this. Mark Twain, this is years and years ago, Mark Twain said, and he once quipped, the trouble with the world is not that people know too little, but that they know so many things that ain't so. Amen? They know some things that's just not so. They know so much. To help us know what is right and what is not right, we're going to examine tonight the Thessalonian believers who had veered into some swampy areas of their own. So, Roman numeral number 2. Now, can somebody help me out? What was Roman numeral number 1? All right, extremes we need to guard against, right? That's what we wrote down, I think. I hope everybody did that. Number one, extremes we need to guard against. So we've got that down. Number two now is truth we can count on. Let's put this down so we have it in our minds. So we're biblically based people. We know what we believe. So truth we can count on. First of all, the Thessalonian church was troubled by extremism, ecstatic about Christ's imminent return. Some people actually had quit their jobs back in those days and become freeloaders. And the Bible calls some of them busybodies. And also troubling the church was fear based on misinformation. The people were afraid of their Christian loved ones who had died already and before Christ coming. And they somehow felt like maybe they would be forgotten. God, what's going to happen to those people or somehow miss his return? So Paul actually builds for them a firm theological foundation. So now we need to take our Bibles and we need to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Write that down, but turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Now here is where we are going to learn some things from the apostle that's really, really important. So we're going to start with verse number 50 and 51. Look what it says. Now, I want you to understand this is such good stuff. Now this I say, brethren, talking to the church again, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. Now, can you imagine keeping this body, the one we have right now? I mean for all eternity. This is a flesh and blood body. Yeah. What happens when the body dies? Or what happens to us right now as we live? Now, there are some young people here, right? And then there are some folks that are not so young. And I wouldn't say old people. I just say not so young. But young people don't have too many wrinkles. Young people don't. Old people have wrinkles, right? I mean, that tells people that we're getting older. And you young people are going to have to face the same thing. So you look at us and we have some wrinkles and we have some flab and, you know. I mean, but I can't imagine that somebody would say, well, we're going to go to heaven in this body. I can't imagine. I don't want this body. I have arthritis. It hurts. Amen. Some of you have lumbago. It hurts. Some of you have heart problems. It hurts. Some of you have headache problems. It hurts. Well, I don't want to take this to heaven. We need new bodies, right? So the Bible teaches us that we're not going to keep the old body. It's going to be changed. Go to 52 and 53, same chapter. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be, there it is, changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. Amen? Yeah. The answer to the mystery or the secret that Paul is trying to whisper in our ears right here is, psst, psst, hey, listen up, listen up. We're all going to be changed. Yeah. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, from mortal to immortal. Yeah. We're going to be changed. This body's not going to go to heaven like it is. We are going to be changed in a moment in the twinkling of an eye in order to get to heaven. Now, in the instant it takes to see a spark in an eye, that's how our bodies are going to be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. Well, what will our bodies be like? What are they going to be like? John chapter 20, verse 19 helps us out. And so does 1 John chapter 3. Now, I want somebody to get John chapter 20, verse 19. I want you to get ready to read it to me loud and clear. And then I want somebody to get me 1 John chapter 3 and verse number 2. So in the moment, in a twinkling of an eye, our bodies will be changed, unrestricted by time and space and matter. So what does it say? Then I need 1 Corinthians 15, 54, and 55. So let's read, first of all, John 20, verse 19. Who has it? If you can read for me. Yes, sir, brother. Go ahead and read it loud and clear.
Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and saith unto them, peace be unto you.
Now, here's something else. You got to understand this. They were in a room. The doors, the windows, and everything was shut. Jesus was not in there. But all of a sudden, he was in there. Now, how did he get in there? With his spiritual body. It's not like this flesh and blood body. It's a body that can just, whoop, go right through the wall. Amen? That's not fanatic intensity here. This is the truth. He wasn't there. All of a sudden, he was there. Wow. But that same body he could eat with. That's amazing. We've never seen a body like that. Amen? We've not, no one here has ever witnessed anybody that's got a body like that. I could bring anybody up here I wanted to. I'd say, okay, walk through that wall. Could you do it? Not in this body, you couldn't. I'd love to bring somebody up and just see if you could try. No, you can't do it. But in the new body, in the changed body, from mortal to immortal, you could. Okay, let's go a little further. 1 John chapter 3, verse 2. Who has that, brother?
Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is.
Amen. We're going to be like who? We're going to be like Jesus in his glorified body. That's awesome. You just say the word of God about the glorified body. It's a beautiful, beautiful study. Now, let's go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 54 and 55. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? And O grave, where is thy victory? Powerful setting of scripture. Finally, death will close its mouth and never again open its jaws ever again. Now, regarding Christ's coming and others joining, go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 15 and 17. Somebody get that for me, please, and we'll have you read it in just a second. With these strong truths in hands, we're going to turn to 1 Thessalonians, where Paul lays out the order of events at Christ's dramatic appearance. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 15, 16, 17. Who has that for us, please? All right, brother, read that again.
1 Corinthians 4, starting verse number 15. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain in the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel,
let's stop right there a second. I'm going to have you read the rest of it in a second. But who's coming? Who is it? The Lord himself. Who is the Lord? The Lord Jesus. He's not going to send an archangel. He's not going to send anybody else. Who's coming according to Scripture? Man, we're really learning some stuff tonight that we can go out and argue with people if we wanted to. Who's coming? Who's coming, everybody? Jesus. How do we know that? Because the Scripture said the Lord himself is coming. Yeah. All right, go ahead and finish reading that. That's great.
And the dead in Christ shall rise first.
Better stop right there. What? What did you just read? But the dead in Christ shall rise first. Who are the dead in Christ? Those who are in the grave.
My mom and dad.
So, yeah, my mom and dad. So all these folks in the grave, before we ever go, what has to happen? They have to come out of the grave first. So here we go. Here we go. It's going to be a great day. You better get ready. You better keep ready, like Miss Bessie says. Come on. He's coming. And all of a sudden, he's coming. There's going to be a shout and the voice of the archangel and the trump of God. And all of a sudden, the graves will pop open. And the souls who have been saved and born again will rise up out of that grave. And then we, which are alive and remain, shall be caught up with them together. Descend in the air, Amen. All right. Go ahead and read the rest of that now.
Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord.
Amen. Now, let me ask you a question. This is not soul sleep. This is not soul sleep. It does say asleep, right? But it never mentions soul sleep. It's the body that's resting. Where does a person go who is a Christian when he dies? Now, we already know he dies and we lie him in a casket. And the body then is taken to the graveyard and buried. We know where the body is. Sometimes the body is in a little urn. You know about that, right? Now, whether that's right or not, you have to decide that. I'm not talking about that tonight. But people are being burned instead of going to the grave. You know why? Because it's cheaper. And people don't want to fool with having to pay the big expense of a big funeral of $12,000, $14,000. When you get that incinerated for $1,500. So that lots of people are doing that. And of course, because everybody got so much concern about property being gone and no land value for farming, and we don't have much space anymore. Oh, we have a lot of space. Remember years ago when they said, you better be careful, the Lord has come. Here's some of them, those fanatic intensities. We're running out of property. We're running out of farming space. We're not going to have enough farming to keep up. And we keep hearing some of that. That's a bunch of junk. Just drive through Kansas once. You can't see anything for literally hundreds of miles except farm property. You drive anywhere. That's not, none of that's so. The Lord's going to come anyway. Amen. He's coming. But where does a person who's saved, when he dies, he goes to the grave? Where does his spirit go? Goes to be with the Lord. What did the Apostle Paul say? To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Now, so when Jesus comes, he's bringing the spirits of those people back with him who are up there. And the body that comes out of the grave is going to be, isn't that going to be a great day? Woo, you talk about shouting. You say, well, I don't think we ought to shout. Why not? Man, you get that spirit coming down, the body coming up, and they go, boop. There's going to be some shouting. Hey, Grandma, good to see ya. Because you're going to be known as you are known. Wow, what truth this stuff is. This Bible has all the answers. It's there. It's there. Now, so let's break everything down into events. I'm going to give you, I want four steps here. I want you to tell me what the four steps are. I've already got them written down. But I want you to tell me. I want to see if I've said enough that you have got it in your mind what the Bible teaches. Number one, who descends from heaven? Lord. Who descends?
The Lord.
The Lord. I want everybody to say it. Who descends from heaven?
The Lord.
The Lord. Jesus, the Lord. He said, he himself is coming. Yeah. So he descends from heaven. That's point number one that we're writing down. Jesus comes from heaven himself. Now, what will you hear? Tell me what you hear. Number two, what am I going to hear? I will hear a trumpet. What else am I going to hear? The voice of the archangel. Somebody said, I heard that. A trumpet, voice of the archangel, and what else am I going to hear? It's right there in the book. Doesn't say a shout. Doesn't say a shout. There'll be a shout. Now, what kind of shout is that? I'm not sure. But some poor folks who don't like to express and shout in church are going to have a problem. I don't know what you're all going to do if you don't. I want it quiet. I want it really reverent. Well, I like reverence too, but brother, when the best thing in the world ever happens to you is somebody gets saved, somebody ought to shout.
That's right.
It's the best thing that ever happened.
That's right.
It's amazing we can go to a ball game and shout and scream and carry on, and the best thing that ever happened to you got saved.
Amen.
Somebody ought to be going, woo, glory, wow, he got saved. But the Bible says this anyway. Give me the three things. Number one, there is going to be a... Come on, when I do this, you say it. Ready? On one, two, three. There's going to be a...
Shout.
Shout. Then there's going to be number two, voice of the archangel. And number three, the trumpet. That's what we're going to hear. Who's coming with all that noise? Jesus. Jesus, our Lord. Now, this is the truth from the Word. Now, what happens next? What happens, somebody? The dead in Christ rise. So, all of a sudden, you talk about a climactic day. You hear the shout, the voice of the archangel, the trump of God, the Spirit coming back to meet the body, the graves are busted open, and everybody's going up. This is going to be a really climactic day. Exciting time. I just can't hardly imagine. You go, who waking me up? What's going on? I think people are going to be going, woo hey, glory! Hey, Jesus!
Yeah. Yeah.
And then what's going to happen? Then we, which are alive and remain. So all of a sudden, everybody's going, whew. Now, there's been stories and films. And sometimes the filmmaker does a little bit odd stuff. Doesn't always stay close to the scripture. That's what confuses some of us. Because we've sat and watched those movies and we said, well, that's not what the movie said. Well, I'd rather believe what God said than what a movie said. The movie's trying to sell tickets to make money. Okay? So, you see, we have nothing to fear concerning our Lord's return. Because even those who have died before will rise to meet him in the air. They will be the first to gather to Christ. What a family reunion will be there. Husbands and wives, parents and children, friends and relatives, separated by death, will join hands once again to live forever with Christ. Regarding confidence and comfort, look at verse 18. 1 Thessalonians 4:18. What does 1 Thessalonians 4:18 say then? There you go. Therefore, comfort one another, right? With these words, comfort one another. You see, this ought to be a fun thing for us to talk about every time we gather. I'm going to comfort you folks because Jesus Christ is coming, but he's coming after those who are saved.
Yeah.
Who have trusted the Lord Jesus Christ. Tell the whole world that. Tell your best friends at work that. Listen, I heard the other night at church, Jesus is coming after those who are saved. Not saved the way you think, but saved the way the Bible teaches. That's what's important. And we have confidence. Paul's words are for those who are fearful, who wonder if Christ has forgotten somebody. He's not going to forget anybody. Amen. He's not going to forget anybody. Roman numeral number 3. In response to Christ's coming, what's appropriate? We got to get down to brass tacks here. In light of all that we've learned tonight, we must ask ourselves, what does it mean to be prepared for Christ's coming? How do I respond to this appropriately? Well, Paul provides us more in the book of Titus. So would you go to Titus chapter 2, verse 11, 12, and 13. Titus chapter 2. So what's appropriate? That's where we're at. We're at Roman numeral number 3. Now we said, first of all, what was Roman numeral number 1? Extremes we need to guard against. There are some extremes we need to guard against, and we've learned that. Fanatic intensity and theological ignorance and theological misinformation. But truth we can count on regarding our death and life is so important. Now, in response to Christ's coming, what is appropriate? Let's read Titus chapter 2. Let's get somebody else to read. I haven't had except these two fellows. Let's get somebody else to read, just to get somebody else. Yes, sir. Titus chapter 2, please, 11, 12, and 13. Let's see what it says. All right. Write this down, please. This is the first thing underneath this last Roman numeral 3. Make certain you have taken what God has given. What has God given? Salvation. Can you remember that? I want to ask that question again. I want you to answer that for me. Make certain you have taken what God has given. It says, for the grace of God which has appeared, bringing salvation. God has had the grace. He's given you salvation. He's taught you in the Word of God about salvation. Make certain you have taken what God has given. Now, it's not your salvation, it's God's salvation. It's not how you think about salvation, it's what God's Word says about salvation. Salvation is only through Jesus. There's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. We've got to come to Jesus Christ. So, that's important. Christ died to pay for our sins. And he rose to give you eternity. To be forgiven is to receive life. He asks simply that you place your belief in him. My question to you is, have you? Have you placed your belief in the Lord? Number 2. Continue to resist a corrupt lifestyle. Now, sometimes when people get saved, they don't resist the corrupt lifestyle. They'll still live the way they did before they said they got saved. Folks, you've got to resist that corrupt lifestyle. Read that one more time, brother, if you will. Would you please read that whole thing? I may stop you, so go ahead.
For the grace of God that brings salvation hath appeared to all men.
Stop right there. Do you see it, the first point? Make sure you do what Jesus Christ has given you. Salvation. Does everybody see it okay?
Yeah.
Make sure you do what he says about salvation. You got to make sure that's first. All right, now go.
Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly.
Stop there. Now, what should we do after we say we've gotten saved? We should live soberly, righteously, and godly. Now, how do I know how to live like that? I go right to the Bible and I find out what it means to live righteously, godly, and holy. And I live like that. That's where we fail in America. Because I don't know how many people you talk to, but when I go out soul winning and talk to people, oh, I've been saved, Pastor. And they're drinking, and they're cussing, and they're doing all kinds of worldly things. Folks, if you're saved, let's live righteously.
Amen.
Let's live holy.
Amen.
Let's live godly.
Yep.
Now, if you don't know what that means, talk to the pastor and say, show me in the scriptures where I'm to live like this. I want to know it. Now, I'm only trying to dig a little bit tonight because I want to make sure everybody in this room is saved. I mean, I love you and I appreciate the opportunity to come here and speak with you and to talk with you. It's always fun to come. But live right. Let's live right. Let's do it right.
Yeah.
And if we don't know how, let's learn.
Right.
Very important. We're looking for his return. So I say Paul instructs us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires so we won't be caught unprepared. Are we living godly? Now, answer that question yourself. I'm not going to have you raise your hand. But are you living godly? Are you living righteously? Are you living holy? Don't try to deceive yourself. All right? Next thing. Live in a sensible, godly manner. Here we go. Go ahead and finish that. So, live today like you expect Him to come today. Now, I don't know, I preached a sermon in Shelby, Ohio last week when I was there. And I preached the sermon, "Have you messed up lately?" And I said, "How many in this church have messed up?" Well, it's like every church. Half the crowd raised their hand. The other half didn't raise. I said, "Some of you just messed up." They just looked at me. I said, "Seriously, don't you can't tell me you haven't messed up in life. Everybody's messed up. I've messed up. You've messed up. We've all messed up. We've all done stuff we shouldn't have done. That's called messing up. And when you won't admit it, that's a bad thing. Because you won't see the error of your way. Can't do that. Can't do that. So the third thing is, live in a sensible, godly manner. Live as if Christ might come now. Stay involved in Christ's program. Give yourself to the Savior. Share His love with others. And I got to ask you a question. Do you do all those things? Now, you don't have to answer yes or no, not nod your head or anything. Just I'm asking you to answer internally. Do you do those things? Listen, I want to make sure everybody's ready for heaven. I preached this way to my church. I preached this message to my church back in 1990. I did. I keep record of every sermon I ever preach. I preached this back in 1990. And because I didn't think the people got it the first time, I preached it in 2007 again. And because I didn't think they got it again, I preached it in 2012 again. Because it's an important message. It's so important. Jesus is coming.
Right.
And let's just learn how to do things right and live right and do right, and God will bless.
Right.
He blesses those who do things practically right. It's important. So, one day there's going to be a morning like no other. There's going to be a thunderous shout, a blast of a trumpet, the voice of the archangel. The skies are going to split. The graves are going to pop open. Jesus is going to come. Souls are going to be lifted up. We who are alive and remain are going to be caught together with Him in the air. And then we're going to live forever with the Lord.
Amen.
And do you know what it says about that in heaven? There will be no what? Give me some of the no's in heaven. There will be no more crying, crime. There will be no more crying. No more disease, no more suffering. For all the former things, whatever we list, all the former things are passed away. Wow. I don't know about you, but I'm excited about that day. As I get older, I get more excited. Because I'm getting closer to going. Some of you are not going to go just yet, but I'm getting ready. I mean, yeah, amen. I'm 76. Wow, that's pretty old, isn't it? Phew, goodness. My wife's even older. Oh, goodness. Ladies and gentlemen, on that great getting up morning, fare thee well, on that great getting up morning, fare thee well. Are you ready to go?